participants and the chair, session chair for today's second session of the day, Dr. Dilip Barad sir. Yesterday we have heard him and it was really very wonderful and interesting session. We were looking forward now what will be the sequel of that. So we all are here for this next session and I request Dilip sir to go ahead with his session. Thank you so much sir and over to you.
Thanks. Thanks a lot. Okay, so yesterday we discussed about technology in context of NEP and shared some of the examples. And some very interesting questions were raised by some of you. And one question was about how technology can be used in literature classroom. That was there. And I told that we will discuss tomorrow. So today we will start with that how technology becomes a very interesting and integral part in variety of ways in literature classroom, wherein we require lots of analysis, critical inquiry, critique of several things that is necessary part also. So a couple of examples we will see in that context also. Then also about language also. So how some collaborative tools can be used.
Hello, Dilip sir. Hello, sir.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, yeah.
Sir, can you raise your voice, sir? Can you, please? I'm not audible.
Yeah, okay. Is it the problem with everybody or?
No, sir, it's okay.
No, sir, it's clear for us.
Yeah, okay, because I think it is normal, like yesterday only.
So, yes, sir, it is normal.
It's clear to all of us, I think, Dr.
Yeah, it's clear.
Anita, yeah, please take your connection itself, so it will be clear to you then.
Okay, fine. So this and then another part like how some collaborative simple tools which can be used even in face-to-face mode also. So now we think of hybrid mode or mixed mode. That it's not that online only, but along with online, if we have this, then also we can do that. That also we will see some part here. Yes, so can I get the sharing rights here? It is there.
Yes, sir, it's given.
Okay, fine. I'm sharing a screen here. Okay, fine. Just a minute. So first we have to start with the question, which was about literature that we have seen yesterday. Let me share a screen. Okay, so on the second day of our presentations, let us see these points that we want to see. Okay, so I'm planning to see that I would like to cover up this topic. Let us see how many of those things we are able to cover today. So technology for literature classroom is the first concern that we were looking at there. So now when I think of literature, for example, if a question is raised by a Marathi literature teacher or a Hindi literature teacher or Gujarati literature teacher or any regional literature teacher, then perhaps the things may be different. But so far as English literature is concerned, then we can see that this literature has these characteristics and we need to cater to these characteristics. Now, though I am concentrating or stressing the concept of English literature here and trying to keep regional literature a little bit out of this periphery, but yet, but we have also have seen that even in regional literature also, to a greater extent, if not completely like this, things are required. And we will see where those differences can emerge also. This literature, English literature, in context of India, obviously is a foreign literature. It's foreign. The foreignness of literature comes from cultural anonymity, social code of conduct, religious inconspicuousness, mythical aloofness, difference in shared collective unconscious, the geographical remoteness, that all plays a vital role in looking at this idea that where do this literature stand and how do we locate this idea also. Now, maybe if we see regional literature, then we do not find much of a cultural anonymity, like the culture will remain similar, except whether that voice is coming from tribal region or some marginalized caste, Dalit voice, then maybe the cultural things can be seen. Social code of conduct by and large remains same. Religious things may change if it is a tribal literature. Otherwise, it will remain still similar. There won't be much of mythical aloofness. I'm talking about regional literature. Now, it doesn't mean that it won't be completely. It will be still there in that context also. So, I many times refer to this myth of Mahishasur. By and large, the Indians believe in the story of Durga, where the antagonist is Mahish. Now, in the Dalit narrative, perhaps the Mahish may come at the space of protagonist. So then the entire narrative will change. The very idea about who is antagonist, who is protagonist, and why that conflict is happening in that narration. We don't know about what happened in the history. We don't know whether it is mythical, the myth is a history or not. But whatever way it is narrated, we obviously have two separate. So that mythical aloofness can play somewhere a significant role in understanding this. Difference in shared, normally we do not have a difference in shared collective unconscious here. Geographical remoteness may play a vital role, There won't be much of such kind of historical distance as we see in Greek, Latin, English literature and Indian context there. So keeping this in mind, regional literature teacher and what are their needs of literature, technology in the classroom, and what is the need of English literature may slightly vary also. The way English literature classes may necessarily require some form of technology in solving some problems, perhaps regional literature may not require. For example, if I am dealing with Macbeth, if I am dealing with Macbeth play, if I am teaching, then and I am teaching some text in Marathi literature which is dealing with Shivaji Maharaj. Now in that case, if I want to show the Gad of Shivaji Maharaj, Pratap Gad or other place, then I can take my students on a picnic. Or I can ask them and they can travel. It won't be very costly. We can manage time, money, everything, and we can visit the place and feel. That is what normally people do, either in schools or colleges. They do visit those things. Now, if it is Macbeth, it is Scotland. And if I were to take my students to Scotland and see the Gard of Macbeth, then it will be nearly impossible. So what I have to do, I have to travel. I have to travel through Google Earth and then I have to take the students there. So, for example, if I use maps here and take the students to that place. Just a minute. I have stopped sharing here. And I search the place. And then I go there to see where actually is this Scotland found here. Yeah? Let me share the screen again. Yeah. Something hit and it got disconnected. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so I would take a journey from where we are located. So you will see where you are in India, and from there you take a flight, a virtual flight. Now, see, the technology has already entered in the classroom, yeah? And then you go to the place, Scotland. And very north of United Kingdom, it is not England also. It is not England, a completely separate country, Scotland, and Inverness. This Inverness is the place where we find the Gards of Macbeth. And then if you want to watch, then if you search for Scotland, Macbeth, and there is a tour of Macbeth's places, when we see this, then we come to a site, a culture trip site, which takes a tour of Macbeth's Scotland in 13 places. So our concern was to see the Gard, Pratap Gard or Scotland Gard, and then we see lot many places, which is coming in the places, geographical locations, the visual journey we can take of this place, and we can understand that what might have been the condition in 11th century when actually Macbeth was living, and those places. So some of the places are still alive. There's Glam's Castle, which is the part of this Cawdor Castle, also that remains there. Yeah, so that is one way of looking at this idea that how this plays a significant role in this. So on one hand, you have a geographical location which is so near, and if you want, you can take your students to that locations. But even in regional literature, if you are teaching Gujarati novel translated in Marathi or Assami or Tamil or Kashmiri, then that travel in country like India won't be easy. That won't be easy, and some form of digital repositories will be required. Map is one very interesting digital tool which we can travel. So normally in our literature classroom, we insist that whatever literary text students are studying, whether it is from India or abroad, they have to visit map and see that what is the journey that the protagonists are making. Go through the map, Google map, and see and locate those places on the map wherever those characters are making their journey. So that is something, a very integral part of teaching pedagogy in literature classroom, where you use map, and that is Google map. It's a very interesting tool, a digital tool, which we can look for. Okay, well, let me come to a few more points here, apart from this. So this is one aspect, and then I'm sharing the screen again. Okay, then, for example, we were discussing this poem. It's a poem, it is a part of New Criticism. So in your class, normally poems, we know that we read poem word by word, and try to open the entire poem. This happens in all languages, irrespective of which literature you are dealing. You might be doing that. Now, when we were studying this poem, this line, that Hawthorne's smile like milk splashed down from noon's blue pitcher became very difficult to open up. The other part was opening. It seems like it is a nature poem. It's about rain. It is about noon time, evening time. Clouds are there. So it's a nature poem. And but this words, Hawthorne with capital H, it was written, smile like milk splashed down, and noon's blue pitcher was very difficult to open. So when we were doing this analysis in the class, we asked students, and students who are studying another novel also, like Nathaniel Hawthorne, Nathaniel Hawthorne's A Scarlet Letter, also they are studying. Now this Hawthorne will obviously tell them that this must be the surname, last name of somebody. And Hawthorne's smile like milk is placed down, so it must be something about a human being's smile. But then milk is placed down is a simile, very difficult to get. Very difficult to get this simile here. So when we ask that, well, let us Google. What do you use? Google image. Use Google image. And when we search this, we found that Hawthorne is a shrub. Hawthorne is a name of a shrub. Once in a while, in a seasonal change, they grow white color flowers. And now if you are a cloud and looking from the up, then there is green meadows, and the white patches seems to be like a milk splashed over meadows. So that is the imagery that the writer poet is using here. But without watching this image, that Hawthorne is a shrub, and it has a white color flower once in a season, and when everything is green and there are these white patches, it looks like a milk splashed down. It was a very difficult image to even imagine. This is geographical aloofness. Hawthorns don't grow in our region. We have rarely seen such a kind of a thing from up above the sky, where meadows and white patches gives us an image of milk splashed over. So it was very difficult to crack this image, but Google image helped us. What helped us now? Another tool. The tool is image.google.com. So when we search image, it is helping us in opening up our poem or literature also. The another word was noon's blue pitcher. Now, noon, it seems like noon is afternoon, or noon is personified. and it is carrying a blue pitcher. So it is image like Panihari, yeah? Panihari, yeah? A woman going somewhere to fetch water in a pitcher. So it might be blue pitcher, and that is that is what came initially. But was it true? Noon's blue pitcher, again we had a doubt, and we said let us go to again to Google and see what Google is bringing. And we found this image, blue pitcher and the flower splashing down. And this is a painting drawn by Susan Noon. So what we thought that Noon is an afternoon time was actually a surname, last name of a painter. Hawthorne, which we thought is a surname, was the name of a shrub. So what we were thinking and how our thinking changed. Why? Because Google image, it took us to this image. And it helped us in explaining, understanding the entire poem in a very interesting way. So that is how the technology or image search can become integral in understanding the poem or some metaphors or imageries in the poem in an interesting way also. I would like to have one activity here. Let us do one small activity here. And this is something that we want to see as a part of this activity. And let me share a link with you where you have to click the link and you will come down to Jamboard. Jamboard app will open when you click on that. And some instructions are given there what we are supposed to do. And let us see how it works. Let us see if all of you are able to also do that or not. So I'm sharing a link first of all in our chat box, and let us see whether we are able to do something or not. In the chat I am putting this link. Okay, I have shared a link in the chat. Are you able to open? Just a minute. Yeah, I have to keep it open. Yeah, okay. I got your email IDs also. So right now it will pose a problem. Just a minute. I got your email IDs. I'm sharing with those email IDs. One of you has given me Rediff mail ID. Okay, fine, but I think we'll be able to work.
Sir, all have not shared. There are total, I could see 20 participants, 21. Okay. But out of that, only 18 have shared their mail IDs. So I have shared the list with you accordingly.
Okay. I am sharing that also with all of you. Let me open this. And
okay.
Yeah. So in case anybody who is left out, you can also share your email in this. I'm sharing one document. Yeah.
Okay.
In the chat, I am giving one document here, and you just have a look at your email ID if it is correct or not. And if need be, please edit also. I have shared another link of a spreadsheet, and just have a look at the email ID that is mentioned there. If you think you want to edit, then please edit your email ID also. Today, we will require your email ID for 2-3 activities, for a couple of activities. Today we will require you. So with that email ID, I am going to share a couple of links with you. So let us ascertain that the link that we have, the email ID that we have is correct. Yes, are you? Yes, many of you have come to this page also. Just check your email ID. If it is not there, add. Please give Gmail email ID. One or two, we have Yahoo also. So if you have Gmail, then please give Gmail. Rediff mail also is there, and some institutional are there. I think institutional email IDs must be run by Google, so there must be perhaps a Gmail service. It will be good because we are going to use a couple of Google services today. So if you have Gmail, then it will be more convenient. It will work with others also, but in case you have this, then that will be good. Prefer Gmail email ID. I got one. Yes. If anybody's email ID is missing, then you can write or check your mail. Yeah. Any doubt, then let us know. If you have any doubt, then please let us know. Okay. Yeah. This is here you have put. I think Dr. Suganthi has put here. Yeah, if you can go to that list, I'm copying right now. I'm taking it from here. But the other participants, if you can go to that link and put, then it will still be better. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Suganti Dhanaraju, I have put here. Okay, that email ID I have put here. Okay. Yes, everybody. I hope checking your mail, and I have already shared one Jamboard also, and I have Santosh Dhotre is already there.
Yeah. Sir, hello. Excuse me,
yes.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, it shows unable to open the Jamboard. I am trying on my mobile.
Yeah. Who is it? Name?
I'm Sandeep.
Achha, well, your email address is it correct that is given here?
Yes, sir, it is correct. skm.marathi@
Yeah, okay, just a minute. skm.marathi@gmail. No? Oh, are you working with the same ID right now?
Yes,
skm.marathi. Yeah, but sometimes when we work with multiple email IDs in our mobile phone, then automatically it might be going through another one. Just check that when you are opening or trying to open. It is working with the same
hello,
ID.
Sir. Can you please add another mail ID of mine?
Yes, I can. Yeah, you also can, and I can also. Yeah.
May I share it in chat box or?
In the chat box if it is convenient, or in the spreadsheet if it is convenient. Directly put in the spreadsheet or in the chat also, no problem. Yeah, you can put in chat also.
I'm sharing in the chat.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Yeah, the email that you have given, that you should access either through laptop or mobile phone, and then try to open.
Recording in progress.
Yeah, I think I was disconnected. Yeah. Okay. But now I have rejoined again. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Don't change the things right now. Lines and everything you can draw. Just have a look at the thing and what we want to do, we will see. Yeah. Is it okay? Everybody is able to come here?
Yes.
Shall I share this? Yeah.
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So no other email IDs I need to work on. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So this is the screen where we are working. This is Jamboard here. And a few instructions are like, for example, we are teaching Dr. Foster's. We are teaching Dr. Foster's. And then in the very beginning of the Dr. Foster's, these lines are coming there. Till swollen with cunning of a self-conceit, his waxen wings did mount above his reach, and melting heavens conspired his overthrow for falling to a devilish exercise. Yeah. So that is what it comes, which is a very central theme of that play written by Christopher Marlowe, Dr. Foster's famous play. And these lines are very significant because that is the central theme. Now, we ask the students that, well, what do you mean by this? Let us do web quest and find an appropriate image to explain your point. If you want to explain these lines, can you find an appropriate image with the help of which we can work on this and identify or find this? And the source you can use is this that is given here, artsandculture.google.com. That is the source that you can use and explain the context of the Greek myth with reference to these lines from Christopher Marlowe. So that is our quasi mythical aloofness. That is one concern, and we want to understand this. We are using one web resource in the class, and we are asking our students to do that. You will be able to make second sheet here, second and the third sheet. So you can start working on it. Use this, go to this website, artsandculture.google.com. Try to search anything related to this line, which is having a mythical connection, and try to bring in here. And then try to paste an image, image and write up, whatever it is. But come with image. Are my instructions clear? What you have to do? In case any doubt, you can still ask. And if it is clear, then you can start working on. Or any doubt,
should we supposed to click on it, sir? Arts.
You have to copy, or you can type this artsandculture.com to go to that source. You have to copy, paste, copy, or you can just remember the ID and type it. And second page you have to make here at the top, second frame. I have put my cursor there, second frame. So when you click on that, you get the second frame also there. So on this frame, you can put your things here. If you want to, you can put your things also. Okay, one person is not able to open. Let me share with this email ID. Yeah. Yeah, I'm sharing. Yeah. And I can make a few more frames also there. We can keep on adding more frames also. I added one more person whose email ID I got in the chat also. And one more is there. Okay, one more I am taking. Yeah, and sharing with this also. Yeah, okay. So now I think you will be there. Okay. Yes, following the instructions, are we able to move on? Or any problem anybody facing?
Sir, the original text slide, it has vanished. I'm not able to see that.
Okay, I think maybe somebody by mistake has deleted some of those things. So we get a version history, and then I am again establishing this, the version history. Yeah, I'm restoring this. So this may happen when we work with students. Somebody by mistake may also remove those things. So there is this feature of version history, and we can access.
Sir, I think that is the major problem with Jamboard. Students cleaned out all that images.
They might remove that also.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
There is this feature of version history.
But I think in Padlet, they can't do Padlet.
Yeah, that is also a good alternative. Yeah, Padlet also is a good option for that. Yes, yeah. Yes, anybody coming up with the thing? Are you able to explore this resource?
Should I copy paste the image? What should I do?
You can use this web resource, artsandculture.google.com.
Right, yeah.
And with the help of that resource.
Sir, maine open kiya hai usse, ye aa gaya blob opera karke. Aur kuch images
hai. Okay, let me have a demonstration here. So this is the website, yeah. Google Arts and Culture. This is one repository of art and culture, which we are planning to use in our literature classroom. Yeah. And now there is a search bar. Yeah. And what we want to see is something related to those lines there. And those lines are related to this myth of Icarus and Daedalus, fall of the waxen wing and then the fall that happened. The heaven conspired the fall there. So when I give these words, I get these images. So for example, this this if I open this watch Icarus falling, this if I say, because this is what is connected with that myth of the waxen wings and the fall. Now, this resource, this particular resource is helping us in exploring this material in a very interesting way. So there is at the bottom, there is a down arrow. At the bottom, there is a down arrow. I click on this down arrow and I get this full painting here. Then again, there is a down arrow. I again click on down arrow. And this down arrow is focusing on something. It is narrowing down this. And then some text is written there. So there is a visual media. And then there is a text. To flee from the Minotaur's labyrinth, Daedalus and his son, Icarus. The father is Daedalus, son is Icarus, built their own wings. Okay, fine. And then they made their wings from birds' feathers. They found on the ground. They stuck the feathers together with wax. Then they attached the wings to the arms. So this platform is focusing on various parts. And enjoying this flight, Icarus flew too close to the sun. The wax he used to stick the feathers together with began to melt in the mid-air. And that is the reason of the fall of Icarus. And as the father is seeing the son following, he is trying to alarm him, but he is already too late in doing that. And then there are two men on the river edge, watch the scene. The man on the horse is telling the seated fisherman, look at Icarus falling. Then there is the landscape, the entire landscape that is painted here, the picture and this. Then you get the name of the painter and the thing that comes there. So this is how this is helping. And this is, there is a critical analysis also that comes along with that, which says that these two men on the edge of the river, their dress, the clothing is of 17th century, whereas this myth is of Greek time. It is before Christ era, and this is 17th century. So that connection also is very curious or interesting, which can help us in doing some kind of critical reading of painting. Critical reading of the painting is also possible in this context also. Well, so this is, now see this movement of the text, which is a kind of a cyber text or a very interesting hypertext, which is helping us in minutely understanding this painting, which we are using to understand a literary text. That is Dr. Foster's, that we are trying to discuss, but with the help of this also. It might be interesting to see if students are able to come here and do the things and bring something. Then also it becomes very interesting classroom discussion. And otherwise, some web quest requires some kind of practice and some thorough instructions also, that what exactly is expected can also be thought out there. Along with this, there was another thing, that this image, the first image that is there, if we try to study this image also along with that, then it becomes even more very critical. This is landscape with the fall of Icarus, this image. And here there is a side arrow on this, in this material, there is a side arrow. And when I click on side arrow, I get full picture of an image there. And there is something written also to understand this image. Now, obviously, this can be taken in the classroom for critical analysis. We can say that, well, Dr. Foster's, the theme is about somebody who is very much arrogant about the power that they got. That is, Icarus got very arrogant and started flying higher and higher towards the sun, and then the melting of the wax and falling down. So that is what happens with Dr. Faustus, also with the magical power that he got with Mephistopheles. And then there is a fall of Dr. Faustus also. Well, after understanding, then we can say, now watch this image. And in that context, try to see something here. Yeah? And obviously, it is very challenging also. It is a kind of a modernist art where somewhere at the bottom, we see somebody has already fallen. Now, when I go next, this platform itself is very interesting, which helps a lot academically also. When I click go to the next screen, the focus is taken on that part of the painting, which is the limelight. Now, again, I go back, then I find that, well, these legs of somebody and a splash of somebody who has fallen was rarely visible. It was rarely visible. But see the way this entire thing is digitally used, that it takes us exactly at the place where we are supposed to look at the things there. And then I can read several things to understand this painting. If I want to listen some expert talking about this, then there are videos also wherein the expert is explaining this painting also. So that is how this merging of the things has been done on this digital platform also. So that is another example of looking that how technology, different kind of technology, can be effectively useful in literature classroom. Whether you want to have some kind of analysis, critical thinking, but digital tools are helping. They are helping a lot. I know most of you might be using films in the classroom, video clips or film adaptations, which normally we use, which also is a kind of technology. Cinema adaptation also is a technology. And which is helping learners in a variety of ways. It also helps us in various discussions, which we can enrage, we can have in our classroom, along with those cinematic adaptation also. Obviously, students like cinema a lot rather than reading. And so we need to think of tasks wherein they do enjoy cinema or a movie version. But at the same time, they may read also some of the part of the text and come with some kind of analysis or some sort of discussion also in this context. So this is and in a similar way, there are many examples which we can think of wherein technology can become very effective in better understanding of literary text. When it comes to English, we require more of such help and aid because that literature is very coming from a remote location. Far off thing, religiously, culturally, geographically, maybe in regional literature in different way. People may require to understand those things also. Even when we deal with Indian literature, whether it is literature from Bengal written by Tagore or the other writer, then also this all things help a lot in understanding the cultural differences with which we also live in such a vast country like India also. But then this discussion doesn't end only with this idea of using this way technology in literature classroom so that we can have more of discussion and better understanding. It is not only this much that plays a vital role, but it goes beyond this also. Like, for example, let me share a screen. Yeah, okay. Let me share the entire screen. So. Okay, so this is this example we have seen, how it can be helpful. But then now we do enter into an arena where we have this idea that if computers will write poems, then what? If computers will start writing poems, or then what are we going to do? Now, it is not a time where we say that, well, I don't love to write on computer. Well, that is bygone ages. Well, people used to say whether I can write only if I hold a pen in the hand, then only I can imagine. Well, people for quite a long time are typing novels. If you see George Orwell, Ernest Hemingway, they have written all their novels by typing those things. So technology has already come in creating literature. But now we are looking at this, can a computer write a poem or not? And well, let us see. Let us take this small test to see that whether the poems can be written by computers or not. I'm sharing one link again in our, I'm sharing a link in the chat. Yeah. And this link will take you to one Google form wherein small poems are given, small poems. And the option are given, do you think this poem is written by a human being or by a computer? That is, so you have to just select either human or computer, whatever you feel after reading that small poem. Let me share the link and give your email ID. So you get an auto-generated answers also. If you give correct email ID, you will get auto-generated answer, wherein even several links are given. If you want to read still more on that idea, whether you are right or wrong, our concern is not if your answer is right or wrong, but we just want to see that how complex things are becoming. So click on this form and quickly appear in the test. Very quick, you can give a response. It is not very tough. Very simple things are there, and thus you have to select whatever you feel on the first reading. What is your gut feeling? What's your gut feeling that this poem is written by a human or by a computer? Go by your gut feelings. Don't apply lots of logic and reason, but your gut feeling, your first impression, whatever you get, and try to see that. Okay? I think five small poems we have put here. One, two, three, four. Yeah, five small poems are there. And you just have to select, going by your gut feeling, that this is written by a human being or by a computer. Yes, is it okay opening? Are you able to open? You can put in the chat if things are going on well. Yeah, okay. And we have like, you can take around 3 to 5 minutes, five small pieces of poems, and by your gut feelings, you just have to select whether a given poem is written by a human being or by a computer. Now let me see if I'm getting any responses being recorded here. Yeah. Yet not, yet I have not received any response from the participants. Yeah, I hope you are reading the poems. I hope you are able to open the link. Yeah, okay, I got the first, second. Yeah, Suganthi Dhanaraju, I have received. And SKM Marathi from that mail ID also I have received. You also might have received auto-generated email with right, wrong, and couple of links also to verify whether your options are right or not. Yes, two. Yeah, third one we have received from mail, Jasmine. Yeah, I think Jasmine is the right name there. Okay, yes. Yeah, third response we have received. I hope some of you are giving the response. So let us wait for some time for this. Yes, I hope things are going on. Let me check. Yeah, we got more responses. Yeah. Yeah, okay. Yes. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 responses so far. We have received, yes, 10 responses we have received. Yeah, if anybody is still appearing, we can wait for a couple of more minutes. Yeah, okay, one more we got. Yeah. Okay. Okay, by the time some of you are giving, let us see the responses, how we are getting the responses. Let me share the screen. Okay, so like this test is given was given to the other participants and to our students also. So in all we have around 151 responses here, along with 12-15 from this group also. So overall, if we try to see the responses of various participants. Now in the first poem, which is written by computer, and what is surprising is that many of us thought that the first poem is written by human being. Almost 49% thought that it is written by human being, which is obviously written by a computer. So this 50-50 percentage, that is alarming. That is what is the point of concern. That, well, it means that given a choice, we may be baffled. Up till now, when we were reading modernist poems as an experimentative poems and variety of those, Dadaism, Dada poem, and other things, we knew that this all are written by human beings. And so we thought these are experiments. There was no concern. But now suddenly, the new genre is coming, which people call it generative literature, not creative literature, but generative literature. And this generative literature poems, for example, this seems to be like most of us got it correct. 71 got it correct. So it's not a problematic thing. But again, here also, there is 58, 40 kind of thing. Here also almost 50-50 percentage kind of thing that a human poem seems to be like a computer written poem. This is more alarming that it is actually written by human being, but 49% of us feel that it is written by computer. So now see, once the choice is given, then the confusion arises. If there is no choice, then we know that it's all human only, then no problem. But once that start happening, then we start reconsidering the human attempts, human imagination, human writing, human creativity, with fresh questioning and those things also there. So what is alarming here is this, that we do get baffled in identifying whether the poem is written by human or by computer. So that is how generative literature is moving on. Maybe some of you might be aware about this, that there are lot many such algorithmic platforms where people can generate poems. There are many such platforms. One such platform is this poem generator website, where if you want to prepare haiku or sonnet, limerick, then you can give keywords and it will, with the help of algorithm, the way it is set, it will create a poem. If you're not happy, you can click again. It will give another shape of the poem. You click again, the third one. Until you are satisfied, it will keep on playing with the words. It will keep on shuffling the words. And once you are satisfied, then you can pick up that poem also. So many of such platforms are coming with the help of algorithm, wherein the creative process, though we call it generative, you generate a literature with the help of a machine that is also emerging slowly and steadily. Well, we can imagine that someday people will obviously think that this is my human favorite poet, this is my computer favorite poet. We may perhaps start having categories of who is the human favorite or a computer favorite poet. Now, this is very much alarming because we thought that something that is imaginative might not be done by machines or robots. But if you program the capacities of imagination also in a particular way, it will obviously imagine the way you want humans to imagine. It is all about understanding how human mind works. And that is what is coming here in looking at this also. And apart from this, whether this literature will be widespread, we hope that it won't be. The human literature will or should remain in prominent space. And people should not get habituated to generative literature and other things. But that is lesser concern. The humanities or literature is all about critique or critical inquiry. So this attempt where artificial intelligence is moving slowly and steadily, becoming smarter, becoming imaginative, processing natural language in such a way that even humans fail to process. We have done one small test in our classroom that Alexa. Alexa, we know that there is this device Alexa, and we ask Alexa and it brings searches from internet and gives the result. We say that Alexa, Lata Mangeshkar, and then she will bring the songs of Lata Mangeshkar. If I say Arijit Singh, then we'll bring the songs of Arijit Singh. Or I say that read about Hamlet from Wikipedia, and it will start reading Wikipedia page from that. Or just I say, tell me something about Hamlet, and it will read that. Now, when I ask the same question to a student, that, okay, we have studied this text, tell me something about Hamlet. The way the person speaks and the way the Alexa will give me the result, I feel that Alexa is better off in giving the result immediately as compared to human beings also. Humans will tend to make error of data, of fact, of sentence structures, of grammar, various kinds of things. But that machine is designed in such a way that it will not make simple errors of language, because it is now learning how to process language, almost like a natural mind. So NLP is an area which is growing, natural language processing also. And another thing also comes that we all are biased as a human being. And when we write anything, when we imagine anything, when we create anything, our biases, our prejudices do play a vital role in our creative work also. And when we allow machine to do something, we understand our biases also in a proper way. And that is why this study enters into those ideas about artificial intelligence and unconscious biases, our unconscious biases, and how even they are controlling artificial intelligence. Why? Because ultimately, all this coding is done by human being. All the codings are done by human being. So if the software engineer who is a coder, if he has already got some unconscious biases, they will come or creep in the artificial intelligence also. And it will give us the similar kind of result also. Some of the findings are done by the research scholars like Robin Hauser or Kriti Sharma, where they try to study about how the patriarchal biases or feminine things are coming into our artificial intelligence, where obviously in literature we are struggling for quite a long time to see that people are not biased so far as feminism is concerned or post-coloniality is concerned or any such kind of socio-cultural, psychological prejudices and biases. That is what humanities is supposed to do also, and make people or human being and society better from that. But if the direction in which we are going, and we thought that technology is secular, technology is not biased, then we are making a mistake. It is not so. It also is having those things. So this concerns of privacy and surveillance also becomes very integral. Ultimately, literature again stands for something that is freedom of people, personal choices of people. Whereas digital tools are used for surveillance. And then again, you require the humanities people to look at how we are designing our programs. I was reading somewhere this case of Hong Kong. In Hong Kong, there was this conflict with Chinese government. And people were on the road every Sunday or Saturday. They were coming on the road opposing the government. And Chinese government put CCTV camera with face detection technology on all the roads. And they were identifying the people that who are these people and what are they doing? Are they doing government jobs or what? So you can curtail the benefits that can be given to citizens in variety of ways. If you can detect through face recognition and you can identify and locate the people. So the Hong Kong people came with the idea about wearing a mask, like Money Heist or Joker kind of a thing, that they are wearing the mask. And they are so that they are not detected. But then it comes an idea that if you have connected a gun with a CCTV camera and you have given a coding that this kind of a face is a face of a terrorist, where there is a turban, there is a beard and mustache, and if that face is recognized, then automatically the gun will fire in that direction because it will say that this is how the terrorist looks. And well, we know that most of our farmers, agitating farmers, are looking like the similar looks are there. So then what may happen? So even those concerns are becoming very, very interesting or important in the literature classroom about this. this concern that moral machine website, which is run by MIT, which also is looking into this, that when you think of a driverless car, and if that car has accidental brake fail, and it is going to collide with somebody somewhere, in that case, if you are driving a car, you as a human being, and if the brake fails, what will you do? On one side, there is a cyclist going on the another side, there is a pedestrian. From the third direction, another car or vehicle is coming. And you can imagine more situations, somewhere the little children are playing, somewhere the old couple is walking. Now, where will you go? What will be your moral choice? Will you bang with a cyclist or a car, a pedestrian, a young little children? Or will you go towards an old fellow? What will be your moral choice? So whatever choices we are going to make, our machines are going to make similar choices. So when we say literature is generated, it is actually what we ask machine to do, that is what they are doing. It is exactly what we do with our children. Like the children are growing from the childhood, they don't know who are they, whether they are male or female. We make them man or a woman. As Simone de Beauvoir rightfully says that women are not born, but they are made by social conditioning. So we make them, we give gender. We give them religion. We thrust religious identity upon them. We thrust national identity, regional identities upon them. And then we make a robot out of human beings. So they are the robots of cultural conditioning, social conditioning, religious conditioning. We don't think that let them be adult after 18 years. They will select their religion. They will select their nationality. They will select their religion, region, name, everything. After they become mature, but that is normally not thought of. But we are at this juncture where we think that also, that how we are turning humans into a kind of a robot, where they will imagine the way society or culture has told them to imagine. Are all human beings really free, as Rousseau and Voltaire during French Revolution were struggling to see that man is born free, but everywhere in shackles? So literature's purpose obviously is to make human free from all kind of shackles. And that understanding is coming back in a different way through digital or artificial intelligence mode, that, well, to what extent we are free in our imaginations, in our moral code of conduct, or our moral choices also. So if I go on this website and I take a test, and I would say that if on one side there is a truck coming, on the other side there is a cyclist, then I would bang my car with a cyclist, because I know that that is how I can save myself. My survival instinct will obviously save myself and my body, my choice. So if this is how we are going to make a car, then car also is going to do the same thing also. And this has become a very interesting plot in one web series. The name of that web series was OK Computer. In OK Computer, there is one car who is murdering one person. Murder, not accident, but car murder. Because murder is something that is done willingly. Willingly. Humans murder. Machines do accident and kill people. But here, the car murders. There is auto-run car. It is a science fiction kind of a thing about futuristic. And then there is an interesting case that goes around. That also, there is OK Computer, a Hindi web series being made. Akash Gandhi, I think, has made that one also. But then again, this all is reaching towards that. So obviously, in our literary project is to make humans human, but that project is yet not over. The new task comes on us, and that is to make robots human now. That is the new way that we can think of this. So that is how the literature class moves on in the direction of this, literature class and technology. So only using tools is not enough. But what is happening because of all this thing? Now, in this context, we can't afford, we means literature teachers or departments cannot afford to stay away from technology. We need to bring more and more of technology in our classrooms. We need to understand technology in much deeper and better way. And then only perhaps the world can be saved from what havoc the artificial intelligence or this technologies might do in different contexts with the similar kind of prejudices, biases, moral, ethical choices that humans are making for so many years. And that again, we will repeat with our digital world also. So that's how we see, we try to answer this question that technology in literature classroom, why, how? So it is this, tools are there to understand the text, but then beyond that also, we need to look into these matters also there. So that is one part of the thing which I wanted to talk today in this things there. I think we'll take the questions at the end only. Yeah, that will be fine then, okay? Then I move on to another. The another question was about infographics also. We had a passing reference to infographics and this also. So infographics are very useful in teaching also and in expressing ourselves also. These are some of the tools which can be used for infographics. Canva is there, picture chart is there, Doodly can do animated videos also, graphic stuff dot in, and many such stuff are there which can help us in preparing some of the infographics in variety of ways also. So if I, for example, share some of the examples that what kind of thing we imagine in terms of this all things infographically and literature and other thing, then let me share this screen. Now, in case if you want to, we want to use or express something in a minimalistic way, lesser words, and something that gets or reaches to a larger number of people, then infographics are something very handy. We know that because of technology, now human habits are changing in such a way that we don't want to read something that is very long. Even a WhatsApp message where it comes, read more, rarely we tap on that. Rarely we will tap on read more and read. We'll not do that, even for a WhatsApp also. Videos, long videos also, we rarely watch. We'll do fast forward the thing. So now in this context comes an idea that present yourself infographically. And that is also a very interesting skill which can be imbibed in different ways. This is one that average classes, one line, in one line you explain the classics. And that can be seen here. And the same way, this is the another infographic. This Grant Snyder is a very interesting person who prepares this infographics of literature. He shares something very interesting. We have put many of these infographics on the wall of our classrooms. And it gives a very interesting space of debate and discussion also, how people are understanding and how it gives a deeper understanding also of this. We have, let me show some of the this. This also is another one, let me skip this part. Yeah, behind every great novelist is, then you have one childhood trauma, miserable job, moment of self-discovery, episode of debauchery and a kind of thing. But infographically, things get presented and for a learner also, it is good. As a maker of infographic also, it should have a clarity of concept. Only it is possible. This also was a very interesting idea. When we deal with a book and a movie, in all literature classroom, all the teachers might be talking about this. Students obviously want a movie and we want them to go towards book. So we can tell that, well, movie is this and book is this. In movie, you can just see the outer part, the shallowness of the text. But if you want to know the deeper aspects of literature, then this is, it is very huge, far beyond what movie is telling. So infographically, students can get an idea in a very effective way that what do you get when you read a novel or a play? And what do you get when you watch a movie adaptation of that, which is done just in 90 minutes or so? Even when let me go down to another graphic of on movie. This one. So when we study film studies, if a topic of film studies and film analysis, then this graphic helps us a lot. That, well, book and a film, that is fine. It is an iceberg imagery that is used here to tell that. But at the same time, when we study a film, film also is a very deep text. It is also having so many things in a deeper way. So if you do not have that sense of understanding sound effects, costumes, and the design of that, screenwriters' creativity and how they work, directors' creativity, dialogue writers' creativity, then we don't understand film also in a proper way also. So cinema also is very deep. It is not only like we tell in this earlier image. That is good to say, but again, it is not to minimize the idea that cinema is shallow. It also has lot many technicalities, which also we can understand if we have that vocabulary and the things also there. So that is there. And obviously, all these infographics can help us in understanding literary texts. These are all by Grant Snyder has made these things. And again, these are for language learning. This way, if you make a spider diagram, spider diagrams can, this is Frazel Verb idea. It teaches in a better way than any another form. So this infographics things can be useful. This is what's the difference between see, look, and watch. And this infographic can be somewhere an effective way of presenting oneself. So there is the entire different world of infographics that we find in different way that we can see there. And this platforms for example, let me see, let me open one of the platform to see how it works. Let me share the screen again. Yeah, so they have, normally these are all paid versions. They are very paid versions. So we don't normally talk about something that is paid version on such platform, but somewhere they give free also, a free account. I have a free account and it helps in working in this also, in a free account way also. So they give some samples. For example, these are the samples. I want to work on some infographic and I can click on this. I can use the template. This is free of cost. And then I just have to keep on adding my, I have to replace whatever is given here. And I just click on that and I can add text. I can click on here and replace an image. So a template is ready on many of such platforms and which can help us in presenting ourselves in an infographical way also. So this is one example. And now in our literature classroom, normally we find that students are not using infographic a lot. Even if we motivate, it is tough also, not that easy, but we keep on telling that if you're a good painter or if you have a sense of creativity, try to draw the map of what is happening in a play or in the novel, how things are going on, and try to make a project of those things. Here are the templates. These templates are for statistical data, but remove the statistical data and use it for your own purpose. And we find lots of human figures also. Lots of human figures can also be found in working in this manner also. So that way, infographics can be a welcome idea, again, something new that is emerging. And we need to, maybe in the coming days, people will talk a lot about infographics, even in literature classrooms and studies also. So that is that brief part of infographics. This is, I think we have 10, 15 minutes now. One or two activities I wanted to do along with this collaborative tools there. So let me share some links in this here. Okay, yeah, I'm sharing one link in the chat. And then I am, okay, let me go to. This is, again, coming back to the Google tool. This is Google Drive. A link I am sharing here, and I am adding the email IDs of all the participants which I got, and few more I got in the chat, so that also I will add here. Okay, so then you will be able to open that document. Let me share this screen so we can have a demo also along with working on it. Yeah. For example, we are doing an activity either in language classroom or literature classroom. Yes, language or literature. This can be online or offline. It can be online or offline also. It is an interactive platform. So I prepared one spreadsheet that here is one image and describe the picture or write imaginary dialogues. And then I have given one picture of literature. So if it is a language classroom, even this shopping image can work. If it is a literature classroom, then I can bring in an image of one of the scenes of that literary text. And then a space is given that you write your dialogues or description here. And here I share this, I share here. And if I have one Google Group email ID, it is very easy. I have to type only one Google Group email ID and it reaches to all the students. Otherwise, I have to copy paste all the email IDs. Right now I am doing copy pasting of all the email IDs, making them editors. I am making them editors and I am sending. If need be, I can write some instructions also here. And this I am sharing. So you all will get this notification and then you can come here and try to write something regarding this. And a few, I got some of the email IDs in the chat. So let me see if I can get that and share again. Some of you were not able to open from the other thing. Yeah. Okay, so let me add. Okay, I'm adding one more here. But many of you, yes, I'm seeing that we have, Dr. Kulkarni is there, already reached here. And I can see the icon, yeah, because this, I have not kept it open for all. So I have shared with the email ID. So I know who is doing what work. So now see that even if it is in this classroom, for example, I am in a traditional classroom and I have given this task through projector to the students. And then I am at the podium. And at the podium, I can see what students are doing. I don't have to walk in the rows. Walking in the row is not a problematic. I can walk in the row and it can also help. It has its own advantages also. But if I want to overview everybody, what they are doing, then this gives me that benefit to look at everybody at a single go. Wherein when I'm walking in a row, I can see only few students. I don't know what other students are doing in the another a row, but here I can observe everybody that what work they are doing. So it will be good if you come here, and see, then we can see here that how everybody working on this can be observed from by the teacher or facilitator, that how things are going on. So well, we can see that Dr. Sanjay Dhotre, Dr. Priya Jamkar, they are writing something there, yes? Their login ID also comes there. If you keep it open, you won't be able to know this, that who is writing or who is there, but then you can check all the students and that they are doing something here. Okay? So this is Doc, Google Doc from Drive. Yes, good. Thank you, both of you. Yeah, Dr. Kulkarni, Dr. Jamkar. Thank you because this makes very interesting to observe that how it works as a collaborative tool, be it a language class or a literature classroom. We can prepare a spreadsheet also. Spreadsheet also can be prepared in a similar way, and we can work on spreadsheet also in a similar way. So either it is Google Doc or a spreadsheet which we can work. And we can see that. Let me share this also and I will put a link in the chat. And then there are some language tasks which are being prepared there. Yeah, I'm just copying this link and putting in the chat. And then I'm sharing with everybody. So then you will be able to access this. Okay, and I'm sharing with everybody here. Yeah, this is right now it is locked private. And now I add email IDs of the participants. So So this is where I was telling yesterday that if you have a Google group, then it is very much advantageous for all the classroom activities. Just one Google group and things work smoothly. If you have a separate email IDs or WhatsApp, then in different place you have to give. WhatsApp will not be very effective in this. You can give a link and you have to keep it open for all. In that case, you want to know who has done what task. But here, so this is the another Excel spreadsheet in Google Doc where grammar activities can be done about sentence structures and sentence construction. And in a group work, we can see that. Yeah, so we have Mr. Muthu Kumar, we have Mr. Paresh Patel already here. They are overviewing the things there. So you can try writing anything. Don't think about the right or wrong answers, but just to feel that when you write, how it can be observed there. In the previous document, if we see in the previous document, we got some of the inputs and there are still many of you are here. But now this was doc and this one is the spreadsheet. That also you can work. Yeah, I am seeing, Mr. Paresh Patel is typing something here. Yeah. Yeah, so these are some of the easy tools where in mobile also students can work and without any cost, which is very important part for us that it has to be cost effective. It should not have a huge burden on the either teacher or on the students also. And something interactive we can do. And see this. These all things are not only for online teaching or learning. This can be used in a regular traditional classroom, either it may be blended or just completely traditional classroom. There also, these activities can help a lot in working out in different things also. So these are some of the tools which are there, which can be used for interactive sessions in face-to-face. Or in online mode also. The last point I wanted to share is about how we use Google Classroom in literature class, for teaching of literature, how we use or what we do with Google Classroom and how we can get some additional advantage from that. So for example, I will take just 5 minutes, and then if there are any questions or the thing, then we will address those things also. So a variety of classes that we have for each and every semester, various classes. And then when we give the tasks to the students in variety of ways, for example, obviously we can come to know about the work that is done, but I want to show this rubric based assessment. Yeah? So if this is, there is an oral presentation to be evaluated, oral presentation to be evaluated. So in oral presentation, we are sitting in the class or we are in online mode, whatever way we are listening or seeing the student performing and they have submitted their PPT in Google Classroom and we have to sit there to do rubric-based evaluation. So rubric we can prepare in this way. This is the sample of a rubric where you want to judge subject knowledge, organization of ideas, verbal skills, mechanics of writing, grammatical errors, eye contact, enthusiasm, research-based citations, originality of writing, MLA style or APA style citation, that all you want to. So you have prepared a rubric that this is what I am going to check. So whatever we want to check, we will prepare a rubric and we will give the rubric also in advance to the students. And then the students will keep on performing. Once the students are performing, for example, they will get the marks in this way when they work on various rubric, and you just have to select that in this aspect, that is subject knowledge, you were excellent. So you just select this. For example, I tap on this and it becomes very good, or I tap on good, then it becomes this. That is what I have to tap only. That so I have parameters I have kept ready, and now I have to tell students that your presentation was needs improvement. And score will be calculated automatically by Google Class. I don't have to write score. So I'm not doing quantitative assessment. I am doing qualitative assessment. And this qualitative assessment is automatically converted into quantity. So on this side, you see against the name of student, there are marks. 71.43, 60.71. So that is automatically done. So I am not doing quantitative assessment. I do qualitative assessment. This was that concern that in literature classroom, what we want to see is how our students are writing. Yes? This is, for example, say written task. Huh? Written task, and this is the rubric for writing. And when they write, they submit their writing on a blog. Huh? Through blog, they submit. And the parameters we can set, whatever parameter we want to see. And with the help of all these parameters, whatever they are writing, we can judge. Huh? So we can observe their, and we can obviously see the task, missing task, or the work that is done, that can be seen also. So we see a blog here, the blog link is given there, and then we can do the qualitative analysis. Error-free language or relevant image and video is available or not, how many words, and few more things, arguments are made or not, what kind of arguments are made, that all also we can ask, and are they able to explain in the classroom what they have written. So parameters are up to us to decide. And technology helps us a little bit, but human intervention is necessary. The evaluation is done by human beings, but technology is helping. It is helping us in converting our quality into quantitative analysis that we see. And at the end of the thing, we get the entire grade sheet, of all the students. That in all the tasks that were given to them throughout the semester, how have they performed? For students, quantitative assessment is very important. Qualitative is helping them, but they also want to see things in terms of numbers. That where do I stand in terms of number? These numbers are highly motivating. It motivates the learners. So the Google Classroom will give us a grade sheet. Automatically, we don't have to work on all these things, and we get that what is the class average. And where do various students stand in their internal assessment and other thing? So this is technology integrated into the thing, and it is helping us. We can't say that the entire human endeavor will be replaced by technology, but our work can become smarter, more effective with lesser energy and time. We can bring out a better result also. And for learners, it is more engaging also. Learners love to do their tasks, and we can keep a check on everybody that who is done, who is task is missing, who is doing it late. And all these things are in the pocket of students. So students cannot say that I was absent. I don't know that the task was given. None of those 20th century excuses work now. In 21st century, we tell our students that you will have to improvise new excuses now. All those were our excuses. We used to give those excuses to our teachers when we were not completing the task. Now, even if you remain absent, the task is in your pocket. And there are constant notifications which are telling you that your work is done or not. That is the technology and involving learners in different capacities in the classroom of language or literature there. Okay? Okay, so if there are any questions, then we can help. It is already 3:30 also right now here. Okay. Yeah, so anchors of the day, are they there or? I can say that they got so speechless, spellbound and speechless that they're not able to speak. they might have taken a power nap. They might have taken a power nap in between. Let me believe that they are spellbound and they are speechless.
Still, digitization and teaching still has taken distance from the teachers, it seems. Because still we have been...
Please repeat, Dr. Vanke. I broke some words are breaking.
Still, we have been burned by the traditional forces of teaching, and the classrooms so far have not been so much devised, and no resources and materials have been up to that kind of sophistication in ordinary schools and colleges where one could have a constant training of these things and can get into the very calibration of knowing the things and responding to all that. Probably this is one reason why there is some sort of silence around decision as to why an individual cannot immediately respond to this. As contrary as it happens to usual lectures of theories and this literary discussions.
Yeah, I can understand. Yeah, thanks for your inputs. Yeah, you are right. You're absolutely right also, yeah. We need to augment a lot many things. Our classroom dynamics, our infrastructure of classroom, our resources needs to be augmented. Yeah.
This literacy needs to be spread or with some intensity, it needs to be inculcated into the teachers. With just knowing the gadgets personally or operating it in the classroom situations, unless it is done with first-hand experiences, we can't have that kind of vision and just motivation to operate these things along with students and some positive results of this digitization.
Yeah,
I think.
Yes, quite true. Yeah, only gadgets are not going to work. So only giving gadgets will not work. We have to do lots of pilot study, how things are working. That needs to be done. You are absolutely right. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Okay, then can we end the session then if there is any anchor? Yeah.
Okay, thank you, sir. On behalf of all the participants and the organizers of the course, I thank you for being here and thank you very much for the informative lecture you delivered. Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot. Yeah, okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for a great informative session.
Hello, sir. Yeah. Informative.
We appreciate your efforts in the direction of digitization in teaching and learning English language and literature. It was an excellent effort. But in fact, we have fallen short in knowing these things or in following the exact track of what you mean by much of these things.
Yeah.
It's because still there needs some sort of wisdom and some sort of advancement about acquiring these things on the part of we teachers.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, Bharat sir.
Thanks for your comments. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Bharat sir. This is Dr. Preeti Joshi. There was some technical glitch. I was not able to unmute myself for a long time. So I got connected to mobile. But it was a very wonderful session, sir. Yesterday's session and today's session. It really was knowledge enriching experience for all of us. Looking forward for more sessions from your end, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thanks. Thanks a lot. Thank you, everybody. Yeah, thanks a lot. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Okay,
thank you.
I'm leaving.
Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you. Pradnya Kulkarni, ma'am, if you are there, I have made you co-host. Are you there, ma'am?